Hello friends, welcome to my channel. Today we are going to study about the axilla. So we will study briefly about the axillary region. So let's start here. As you can see here, that axilla is a space located between the medial arm and the chest wall. So here you can see the diagram here marked in black. So the axilla is the name given to an area that lies underneath the glenohumeral joint. So this is the glenoid cavity and this is the head of the humerus. So this joint is known as your glenohumeral joint. So at the junction of the upper limb and the thorax, it is a passageway by which neurovascular bundles and the muscular structures can enter and leave the upper limb. Apex of the axilla is directed superomedially and is formed by the medial aspect of coracoid process. The lateral aspect of the first rib, here you can see the first rib. So this is the lateral aspect of the first rib. The superior border of the scapula, here you can see. So this whole part is the scapula. This is the medial border of the scapula, inferior angle of the scapula, and the lateral border, or you can say the axillary border of the scapula. And here you can see the superior angle of the scapula. So the superior border of the scapula and the inferior aspect of the clavicle. So this is the clavicle, here you can see. So the inferior aspect and you can say the inner surface of the clavicle. Posterior border of the axilla is formed by the subscapularis muscle with teres major and latissimus dorsi forming the inferior part. The anterior border of the axilla is formed by the deep margin of pectoralis major and minor muscles. Above the pectoralis minor, the clavipectoral fascia forms the boundary. The narrow lateral border is formed by the intertubercular sulcus between the attachment of latissimus dorsi and pectoralis major muscle. The medial border is formed by the chest wall and attachment of the serratus anterior muscles. The base of axilla is formed by, and you can see it is covered with the skin and the axillary fascia, which forms a triangle between the chest wall and the inferior border of pectoralis major and latissimus dorsi muscle. So here you can see in this diagram, this the axilla, you can see here it is just a cone shape hollow space where you will find the structures, they are going in and out from this axilla. So this cone shaped hollow space is also known as the cervico-axillary canal. So here you can see the head of the humerus. This is a superior view. So this is your head of the humerus and laterally, and in the medially here you can see the first rib, and posteriorly you can see the superior border of the scapula. The apex is formed and bounded medially by the outer border of the first rib, laterally by the head of the humerus, posteriorly by the scapula, superior border of the scapula, and anteriorly you will find here the inner surface or the posterior surface of the clavicle. So it has the lateral wall, it has the medial wall, anterior wall and the posterior wall. So the lateral wall, it is formed by the intertubercular sulcus, or you can say the bicipital groove. Along with that, you will find the biceps tendon, mainly the long head of the biceps brachii. Like that, in the medial wall, that is formed by the serratus anterior to fourth rib, that means the upper four ribs along with the serratus anterior, they take part to form the medial wall. Then you will find the anterior wall. Here you can see this is the anterior wall. So the anterior wall, here it is formed by the pectoralis major muscle, pectoralis minor muscle, and it is supported by the clavipectoral fascia. Like that, he will find the posterior wall. So the posterior wall, here you can see here this is the diagram showing the scapula and the muscles related to the scapula and humerus. So this muscle is known as your subscapularis muscle. This muscle is known as your teres major muscle, and here you will find the latissimus dorsi muscles. So the posterior wall, it is formed by the subscapularis muscle, teres major muscle and latissimus dorsi muscles. Floor, or you can say the base, is formed by the axillary fascia, which is held by the suspensory ligament and lies between the anterior and the posterior axillary folds, the deep fascia of arm and the serratus anterior. So here in this diagram, clearly you can see the anterior border. Here you can see the anterior border, and the muscles are the pectoralis major muscle, and the deep to that you will find the pectoralis minor muscle. Here you can see the medial border, the cut section of this medial border. So here you cannot see the first rib. So below to that, whatever these green parts, they are the serratus anterior muscles along with some other ribs. Here you will find the posterior rib. So the posterior border, here it is, you can see it is by the superior border of the scapula. Here you can see the superior border of the scapula, the teres major muscle along with the latissimus dorsi. So the borders are the overall 3D shape of the axilla, looks slightly like a pyramid. It consists of four sides, an open apex and base. Apex, also known as the axillary inlet, it is formed by the lateral border of the first rib, the superior border of the scapula and the posterior border of the clavicle. Lateral wall formed by the intertubercular groove of the humerus. Medial wall is formed by the consists of serratus anterior and the thoracic wall, ribs and the intercostal muscles includes in the thoracic wall. Anterior wall contains the pectoralis major and the underlying pectoralis minor and the subclavius muscles, part of the subclavius muscles. Posterior wall formed by the subscapularis, teres major and latissimus dorsi muscles. Then we'll come to the contents. The contents, here you can see in this diagram, these are the bundle of structures that is present inside the cone-shaped cervico-axillary canal, you can say inside the axilla. The axilla contains the axillary artery, axillary vein and the subclavicular divisions of the brachial plexus. In green color you can see. So these all run within a neurovascular bundle from apex to the base along the lateral boundary more anteriorly than posterior. The anterior wall carries thoracic branches from the artery and vein. The subscapular vessels follow the posterior wall at the border of subscapularis. The long thoracic nerve descends above serratus anterior on the medial wall of the axilla. The axillary tail of the breast often extends from the chest wall into the axilla. And also here you will find numerous lymph nodes that is located inside the axilla, which is divided into pectoral lymph node, subscapular lymph node, lateral lymph node, central lymph node and apical grooves. So in contents, here you can see the contents of the axilla region includes muscles, nerves, vasculature and lymphatics, axillary artery and its branches. So the main artery supplying the upper limb, it is commonly referred as having three parts, one medial to the pectoralis minor, one posterior to pectoralis minor and one lateral to the pectoralis minor. So the pectoralis minor is the key muscle to divide the axillary artery into three parts. So the medial and posterior parts travel in the axilla. So axillary vein also passes through that along with the axillary artery and its tributaries also the contents of the axilla. The main vein draining the upper limb, its two largest tributaries are the cephalic and the basilic veins. Brachial plexus that you have seen in green color earlier, and it's mainly the branches of the brachial plexus. So a collection of spinal nerves that form the peripheral nerves of the upper limb. Axillary lymph nodes, so they filter lymphatic fluid that has drained from the upper limb and pectoral region. Axillary lymph node enlargement is a non-specific indicator of breast cancer. Biceps brachii, the short head of the biceps brachii, along with that coracobrachialis, these muscles, tendons move through the axilla where they attach to the coracoid process of the scapula. So here you can see the short head of the biceps brachii muscle that takes origin from the coracoid process along with the coracobrachialis muscle. So these two tendons of the biceps brachii muscle and the coracobrachialis muscle. Along with that, axillary artery, axillary vein and the cords and its branches of the brachial plexus is the they all are the contents of the axilla. This diagram we can see the relations of the axilla. So at its apex, the axilla communicates with the root of the neck region through the cervico-axillary canal. We have studied about the cervico-axillary canal. The base has no relations. The axilla is related posteriorly with the subscapularis and scapula and anteriorly with the pectoralis major muscles and clavipectoral fascia. Medially, the axilla is related to the serratus anterior muscle, the chest wall means upper four ribs of the chest wall, that includes all the ribs, all the four upper four ribs, intercostal muscles and vessels, and deep to those the lung. Laterally, the intertubercular sulcus houses the short tendon of byssus brachii and coracobrachialis. So here you can see how this pectoralis minor muscle at the coracoid process that divides this axillary artery into three parts. The upper part is from the outer border of the first rib to the upper border of the pectoralis minor muscle. The second part from just beneath, just deep to the pectoralis minor muscle, from the upper border of the pectoralis minor to the lower border of the pectoralis minor. That means the part of the artery that is just behind to this pectoralis minor muscle will be the second part of the axillary artery. Then you will find from the lower border of the pectoralis minor to the lower border of the pectoralis major muscle part, this part of the artery is known as the third part of the axillary artery. Then here you can see how the brachial plexus, they descends downward with related to the axillary artery. Here you can see the lateral cord of the brachial plexus. Here you can see the medial cord of the brachial plexus, and here you can see the posterior cord of the brachial plexus. So they just surround the axillary artery in lateral way, posterior way and medial way to the axillary artery. Then we will see what are the passageways exiting the axilla. So there are three main routes by which structures leave the axilla. The main route of exit is immediately inferiorly and laterally into the upper limb. The majority of the contents of the axilla region leave by this method. Another pathway is via the quadrangular space. So this is the quadrangular space bounded superiorly by the teres minor muscle, inferiorly by the teres major muscle. So in precisely you can say the lower border of the teres minor muscle, inferiorly bounded by the upper border of the teres major muscle, and laterally it is bounded by the shaft of the humerus. Medially it is bounded by the long head of the triceps brachii muscles. So this space is known as the quadrangular space. So this is a gap in the posterior wall of the axilla allowing access to the posterior arm and shoulder area. Structures passing through include the axillary nerve and posterior circumflex humeral artery, that is the branch of third part of the axillary artery. The last passageway is the clavipectoral triangle. Here you can see marked in red is the clavipectoral triangle. So which is an opening in the anterior wall of the axilla. It is bounded by the pectoralis major muscle, deltoid muscle and the clavicle. So this is your pectoralis major muscle. Here you will find the deltoid muscle and here you will find there is the presence of clavicle. So laterally you can say it is bounded by the deltoid muscle. Superomedially it is bounded by the clavicle and inferomedially it is bounded by the pectoralis major muscle. So there is a gap. So this gap is known as the clavipectoral triangle. The cephalic vein enters the axilla. Here you can see the cephalic vein. It enters the axilla via this triangle, while the medial and lateral pectoral nerve leaves clavipectoral triangle. So this yellow part, they are the nerves. They are just ejecting out of the clavipectoral triangle, whereas the cephalic vein that just ascends upward then turns medially and passes through this clavipectoral triangle to the axilla. Vertically, this clavipectoral fascia extends from the clavicle above to the axillary fascia below. Its upper part splits into two laminae to enclose the subclavius muscle. So here you can see the clavicle. So the clavicle, the clavipectoral fascia, it extends from the clavicle, it splits into two lamina and encloses the subclavius muscle. The posterior lamina, this is the anterior lamina and this is the posterior lamina. The posterior lamina becomes continuous with the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia and get fused with the axillary sheath. The anterior lamina, here you can see the anterior lamina that gets connects to the clavicle. Its lower part splits to enclose the pectoralis minor muscle. So here is the pectoralis minor muscle. This clavipectoral fascia descends downward then splits into two lamina to enclose the pectoralis minor muscles. Below this, it extends downward as the suspensory ligament of axilla that connected to the dome of the axillary fascia. So the suspensory ligament, this is the suspensory ligament, keeps the dome of the axilla or axillary fascia pulled upward, thus maintaining the concavity of the axilla. So here in this diagram you can clearly see that there is a presence of clavicle. This is the coracoid process. So the clavipectoral fascia in green, the descends downward at the when it comes nearer to the subclavius muscle, it splits into two lamina, anterior lamina and the posterior lamina. By enclosing the subclavius muscle, then it descends downward. So at this time, this part is known as your costocoracoid ligament because it connects from the costal part of the thoracic wall to the coracoid process. So this stretched fascia is known as your costocoracoid ligament. Then this fascia descends downward. You can see here again it splits into two lamina, the anterior lamina and deep to that the pectoralis minor, there is the posterior lamina. that encloses this pectoralis minor muscle. Then this fascia descends downward as a suspensory ligament and it blends with the axillary fascia. So this is the suspensory ligament that actually maintains the concavity, the dome shape of the axilla. So when you will see this clavipectoral fascia, you will find some structures are, they are just piercing to this clavipectoral fascia. So here you will find some structures are, they are piercing to this clavipectoral fascia. They are acromiothoracic trunk, the cephalic vein, the lateral pectoral nerve, and the lymphatic channels. So when clinicians refer to the superior thoracic aperture as the thoracic outlet, they are emphasizing the important nerves and arteries that pass through this aperture into the lower neck and upper limb. Hence, various types of thoracic outlet syndromes exist, which is the costoclavicular syndrome, that pallor and coldness of the skin of the upper limb and diminished radial pulse resulting from compression of the subclavian artery between the clavicle and the first rib, particularly when the angle between the neck and the shoulder is increased. Thank you for listening. If any questions, you can ask me in the comment section. If you like my video, then please subscribe my channel and press the bell icon for more and more videos. Thank you.